Please join me in welcoming our next speaker, Dr. Marcial-Vega, graduated from the University of Puerto Rico School of Medicine in 1984. He completed his internship and residency at Johns Hopkins Hospital and University and is board certified in radiation oncology and in integrative and holistic medicine by the Academy for Integrative Health and Medicine. He testified before the Government Reform Committee in 1999 on the use of intravenous chelation therapy and management of cardiovascular disease, cancer, AIDS, and other diseases. He's a professor at the Universidad Central del Caribe School of Medicine and currently holds medical licenses in Puerto Rico and Florida. He focuses on the use of detoxification and regeneration to promote optimal levels of health. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Marcial-Vega.
Thank you. Good morning. Can you hear me well? Thank you. Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's always an honor to be here, and I thank especially Rick Fisher and Stuart Manoli that always are bugging me in the hallways and inviting me to come here, Jim Smith as well, and especially Anita Vasquez, who introduced me to Braulio Jimenez Vélez, who is a professor at the University of Puerto Rico School of Dentistry. I don't know if some of you met him last year in Puerto Rico. He spoke about having the School of Medicine mercury-free. Some of you remember him. So I met him, and since then, we wrote a paper that is being presented, some of the data today here, and he's presenting it in Louisiana today as well, about what we found in Vieques after chelating some of these patients, the metals we found, including uranium. So he just sent them to me about 25 minutes ago. So this is the first time that we'll talk about that particular piece of information. So thank you very much for all the connections. Never thought that would happen so quickly. So as a radiation oncologist, we're never taught about chelation therapy, intravenous ozone, post-electromagnetic frequencies, intravenous high-dose vitamin C, but those are the things that I've been doing for the last 25 years or so. For the last 21 years, I've been very active in doing chelation therapy because a friend of mine told me I should take the course, and I told him, it's a waste of time. It doesn't work. I've seen all the information. I've seen all the data. And he said, no, just go. It's in Orlando, Florida. Take the course, which I did 21 years ago. The rest is history. I could not believe the information that was available at the time. There's much more information available today. And it's unfortunate that chelation therapy works. And the reason I say that is because the only reason it works is because we're in a highly polluted planet. If it weren't for that, it would not work the way it works. So our goal is your goal, which is to clean not just mouths, but the whole environment that we're in. And my goal is to clean the planet for all of us. And that may seem like an impossible dream, but that's what we're aiming at. We know that there are no compartments in the planet. This is like a huge blender. So whatever we're blending on one side of the planet seems to make it to the other side of the planet. And unfortunately, we think that because we don't see particles such as the ones produced by these vehicles, they don't exist. But we're constantly breathing them, and we're producing electricity out of fossil fuels, so a lot of this is going into our air. And this is one of the main causes of a lot of our problems, even though I will concentrate today on how heavy metals are affecting our health. Would you eat food that was grown in a place with this sign on? Well, this is what's happening right now. This is one of the most important slides that I've had in my lectures. If you can have one slide from this lecture to stress, it would be this one. Because they're starting to recognize what's happening in the health of America and the rest of the world. The president, when he got elected, President Obama, one of the first orders that he gave was, I want a report, and this was before he was sworn in. I want a report that says what is causing cancer in the United States. And he gave that order to the National Cancer Institute, the National Institutes of Health, and the Department of Health and Human Services. So this is the President's Cancer Panel Report. It came out in 2010. You can Google it now, and they'll send you a free copy, a hardbound copy of 250-page report. if you're a U.S. citizen or someone living in the United States, or you can download it. And the report basically says what the cause of cancer is, according to these authorities. Now, the interesting thing is that these authorities are incredibly conservative, but they're saying already that the cause of cancer is that, Mr. President, we're going to put the cause of the vast majority of cancer in a picture, and this was the picture. The main cause is pollution of the air, pollution of the water, pesticides in the food, and x-rays. Do you see genetics there anywhere? Genetics is not the cause of cancer, even though if you ask an oncologist what's the cause of cancer, they'll tell you, that's genetic. But that's not true. What's happening is that pollution is causing most of these diseases. And when these authorities are recognizing this, that we have known for 20 years, and you have known, some of you, for 30 years with mercury and other substances, then we gotta start acting more on it. Now, the report says the recommendations to you and to the layperson are the following. The first recommendation, never come with your shoes into your house. Leave your shoes outside because you're increasing the chances of cancer to your family. There's so many carcinogens already on the floor out there that's the first recommendation. Second recommendation, never drink from a plastic container. But the taste of plastic is really nice with these little bottles. But they say that the disruptors and the plastic that is there is causing a lot of the cancer in the United States. They also recommend, the third recommendation or fourth, is never to eat animal products, cheeses, milk, meat, from animals that have had hormones or added chemicals or antibiotics. They don't mention the word organic. They're very careful. But they're basically saying organic food. So it's very interesting that this is already happening. And some of the entities that are stressing and focusing on these factors that are affecting our health are integrated medicine, which takes into account regular medicine, but also takes into account this pollution and this other factors that are affecting us, like stress, lack of exercise, and bad diet. Now, the first thing that we did about this chelation therapy, one of the things that I'm going to present to you is what we did in Vieques. Vieques is an island off of the coast of the main island of Puerto Rico. It's in the east coast. And Vieques has a population of 9,000 people, and it's being used for target practice, not just for the Navy in the United States, but for other military groups in the world for 60 years. It's been 14 years that the Navy has not practiced there anymore, but the incidence of most major diseases in Vieques has been more than expected, higher than expected. It's considered a Superfund site. For those of you that don't know what a Superfund site, those are of the most polluted areas in the United States. They get federal funding to clean the area. Cleaning is a very loose term, and one of the things that we wanted to offer this community, this was not a study. We just went there, people from my office, because it made sense to us to clean the population, not the ground, not the plants, which is okay. That's part of a cleanup process in a Superfund site. But we felt that the most important thing was to clean the population, to decrease the chances of disease and to decrease disease if possible. So the first thing we did, we offered to 60 people a 24-hour urine collection. And the 24-hour urine collection, this first slide that you see here, in 52 patients, as you can see, lead was found in all patients, mercury 65%, aluminum 92%, arsenic 100%, cadmium 98%. So basically, all patients have presence of heavy metals in a 24-hour urine collection for heavy metals. But one of the most important things we found was the following. The standard for diagnosis, monitoring, and follow-up of a heavy metal directed treatment to see if it works or it doesn't work is unfortunately blood levels of heavy metals. However, blood levels of heavy metals, we found a lot of false negatives in patients. And why is that? Because blood levels indicate acute exposure. It doesn't indicate chronic exposure. When you give chelation therapy, it pulls metals from the tissue, so you get the a better idea of what the chronic exposure is. So we haven't been using blood levels for monitoring these patients for about 15 years. So we're using what we call provocation. Pre-24-hour urine analysis of heavy metals, provoke with intravenous EDTA, which I will get to in a while about what the protocol is, and then measurement after the provocation with another 24-hour urine analysis. And as you can see, for example, lead, it went from 1 microgram to 62 micrograms after provocation, 60 times higher. It would have been misrepresented if you just did a routine 24-hour urine analysis. Mercury, the same thing, almost 6 times higher when you do a provocation. False negatives with uranium. Uranium was not detected in many of these patients, but as soon as we did a provocation, it showed up. So that was our first indication that uranium could be treated with chelation therapy to remove it from the body of somebody contaminated. Now, this whole thing about Vieques started in my street in San Juan. I live by the beach. I lived by the beach for 10 years since I've lived in Puerto Rico. And one neighbor of mine, who's also a patient, asked me, why don't you do a 24-hour urine analysis? This was about 7 years ago. And I did, and we found uranium. And he said, why do you have uranium? And then his wife wanted to do the same. She also had uranium. I did it. I also had uranium. 7 people did it in this street. We all had presence of uranium in the urine. So I made a note of that, and as I started doing more and more testing in different patients in different parts of the main island, from the west to the east, north and south, I found uranium in 22-23% of the population, which was very odd. And this is mentioning the provocation that I just mentioned to you. Concentrations in tissue, very difficult to diagnose unless a biopsy is done, which is impractical, but it must be recognized as a potential mechanism of disease. Tissue concentration of a metal while the blood levels are normal. So remember, provocation is very important. When we check the 24-hour urine levels of metals, Isla Grande means the main island of Puerto Rico, and Vieques is a smaller island where the practices took place. We see across the board, and I'll show that in the conclusions, that the levels of heavy metals are higher in Vieques. However, they're not that much higher. As you can see here, the white bars are Vieques, the blue bars are the bigger island. And more patients had higher levels of presence of these metals. You see the metals down here, lead, mercury, aluminum, and so forth. But the people of Vieques had higher levels. Now, we evaluated these patients after doing a 24-hour urine analysis with pH of the saliva. We do a lot of that testing to monitor how supplements are doing, how treatments are doing, because indirectly the pH in the saliva, as you know, should always be alkaline. Acidity will break down enamel, will break down the bond between calcium and phosphate in the teeth, and this will lead to corrosion, degradation, poor health of the mouth. But more than that, it's an indicator of how the body is using the alkaline buffers in the human body. So if the mouth is acid, we know we have a very high burden of acidity somewhere in the body that the body is trying to buffer. So when we see pHs that are below that, definitely we have to follow the patient accordingly. And as the patient's deucination, which removes this acid-promoting heavy metals and other toxins, pH increases. The evolution of chelation was as follows. When we started, when I started in the 90s, late 90s, and a report I did in 2002, I wanted to know if cleaning the human body made any difference with cancer. With my cancer patients that had done regular therapies that had not worked, and I did a protocol with nothing new. This was nothing original. It was just things that I've seen in different meetings, like ozone therapy, intravenous ozone, ozone showers, chelation therapy, high-dose vitamin C, relaxation, biofeedback, sweating with a steam bath, massage. And put that all together, I say, if we see an effect, then we will continue pursuing this natural medicine detoxification theory. If not, I don't think I'll pursue that any longer. So we took back in 1996 to 2002 about 40 patients in a retrospective review of this protocol I just mentioned. Of the 48 patients, 8 were excluded because they had not followed the protocol, which was daily, 5 days a week, for 3 weeks. At the end of 3 to 6 weeks, we did different evaluations to see if there was any difference in the tumor response or any other clinical parameters in the patients. So those 40 patients with different histologies and different tumors. Most of them had started with stage one, but at the time of this evaluation, they had failed chemotherapy, they had failed other conventional therapy, all had progressive disease. Most of them had stage four disease, and no patient was on chemotherapy, radiation, or surgery. So this will give us an idea of whether detoxifying cleaning a human body will make any difference in the treatment of cancer. And again, 5 days a week. This is a massage table. This is a biofeedback machine that measures the breathing with an infrared sensor and sends signals to the ear and the eyes to promote relaxation in patients. This was a ozone cabinet for a shower that we built, and we built it in Florida by RGF Technologies in West Palm Beach. We built 4, and we put the patient there naked, and they would get showered by water that was digitally controlled to be at 38 to 42 degrees centigrade, water that was saturated with ozone, so the ozone would go through the skin, and we also promote sweating, we also promote relaxation and a massage. And this is a steam bath that they will do before doing the ozone shower. So it was not a simple protocol, it was a little bit complicated with these machines, and some of them we had to create. And the protocol also promoted meditation, prayer, aromatherapy, daily monitoring by the physician, and the intravenous protocol consisted initially of 20 grams of intravenous vitamin C in 250 cc's of sterile water with 2 to 6 cc's, which is approximately 600 to 1800 milligrams of EDTA disodium. That's not the same EDTA that we'll be speaking about in a while about Vieques. And the IV therapy was given 3 times a week, not daily. And the vitamin C increased until 70 grams were given 3 times a week intravenously or until tolerance was reached. The ozone hypothermia showers were daily, half hour, 98 to 103 degrees Fahrenheit, kept digitally controlled. The age range of the patients was 8 to 80 years old, and the median was 56 years. The median follow-up was 18 months, and an analysis on 40 of these patients. The initial response of these patients, as you can see, on there's three graphs. The first one is all the patients, and then there's an overall graph of 72% response rate, which is the first one on the left. Response was defined as both tumor response or clinical symptomatic response, an improvement of more than 50% on any parameter, be it pain, tumor reduction, lowering of 50% or more of tumor markers. And as we can see, 76% of the patients responded favorably, and A means patients that finished their program of 3 weeks, B, patients that did not but did more than 2 weeks. So we saw that there was a response, and we were encouraged by these results. By 18 months, 6 of 33 patients had complete resolution of the tumors, which is roughly about a third. And that was significant. Now, what we were not expecting from this was another conclusion that we saw, that other illnesses that the patients had were also reversed. High blood pressure either got better or resolved. High blood pressure, diabetes, arthritis, depression, insomnia, lack of energy, and in some patients, improvement of Alzheimer's, improvement of autism, things that we were not expecting. Improvement of vision, improvement of sexual function, things that we were not expecting. So that's when we started seeing the connection, not only between toxins and cancer, but also between toxins and all other major chronic illnesses that we're seeing. Symptoms always get better before we see a tumor response, and an initial improvement is seen first in sleep and energy levels and overall well-being. So when you start detoxifying people, it's good to pay attention to how they're feeling. So we have to get into their emotional, their spiritual, and their sleeping habits and energy levels during the day. So the first thing I ask these patients is, how's your energy level? How are you sleeping? And those are very good indicators of how these protocols are going before you get into the objective data of blood work, salivary pH, PET scans, CT scans, and so forth. And patients that respond to these protocols also start looking and feeling better. So there's something that goes hand in hand between being sick and not looking good, or looking like you're aging, and being healthy and looking better and looking like you're getting younger. So that's one thing goes with the other. As I mentioned, other diseases also improved. And as you can see here, this is a patient with a metastatic cervix cancer with lymph nodes in the pelvic area. You see the lymph nodes here, one large one here on the left, one on the right, another one over here. And after the program, you see the lymph nodes are still there, but they have markedly reduced, as we see in this slide as well. Another patient with metastatic colon cancer to the lung, we see the nodule here, and afterwards the nodule has greatly reduced. Remember, this was only 3 weeks. We've learned that it's not like chemotherapy and radiation where you treat, send the patient home, no further instructions regarding their health, usually. But here is something that we have to instruct the patient that they have to do things to become healthier and clean their body for the rest of their lives until we do something to clean the planet, because we keep on breathing the same air, we keep living in a major city, and we keep drinking sometimes that water. But now, just changes in diet and water are not enough in many populations, because we're breathing the mercury. We don't have to eat contaminated fish to get mercury in our bodies. We're breathing it now with all the coal-producing plants, the electricity-producing plants that use coal. This coal is high in mercury in many instances. So that mercury is going all around the air, and we've shown in places like major cities that we're breathing these metals. So we have to be very aware of what we're doing. Patient with Hodgkin's disease, the outer circle is the lymph node. 3 weeks later, it was roughly half the size. This patient has stage 4 lymphoma of the abdomen, had not responded to chemotherapy. He also had AIDS, and at the time was incontinent and confused from anemia. And also, as you can see here, anything that all these nodules that look white in the area that is dark inside of the abdomen, this is intestine, but these are nodules of tumor throughout the intestine, the little tiny nodules all throughout. And as you can see, the tumor mass is in this side of the abdomen, this white area, tumor mass of lymphoma. You see the station of the colon from a partial obstruction of this mass. And this is the same patient 6 months later. As you can see, there's no evidence of disease. The patient still has no evidence of disease 19 years later. I spoke with him 2 months ago. So it's like anything in life. It doesn't work with everybody. We're getting these protocols simpler and more effective and more frequent. In terms of chelation therapy, I don't know if you're aware of the TAC study. It's a randomized prospective study sponsored by NIH, the National Institutes of Health, the cardiovascular section. And they enrolled 1,700 patients. And it's amazing because we already have so many studies about intravenous chelation therapy. Now, this is 3-hour infusions of EDTA disodium. EDTA stands for ethylene diamino tetraacetic acid, EDTA. There are several kinds of EDTA. EDTA disodium and EDTA magnesium has to be infused slowly. So you need to do it over a 3-hour period. That's the one I was taught initially 21 years ago. EDTA calcium has the same amount of EDTA, the same heavy metal grabbing capacity, but you can give it over 5-10 minutes, the same amount, and not get a kidney shutdown like you would with the EDTA sodium or magnesium. This was done with EDTA disodium. I don't do this now. For 7 years, I've been doing EDTA calcium, and that's the one that we did for the Vieques patients. But this study did the 3-hour infusion, randomized study in patients that had one heart attack. So it was assumed, of course, that they had occlusion, partial or total obstruction of coronary arteries causing the heart attack. The randomized study put them in weekly EDTA sodium chelation therapy. And the study was designed to prove that chelation therapy was harmful. This study was not designed to prove that chelation therapy worked. So it's interesting. What they found is that the composite percentages of mortality, they put together mortality, chances of having MI, myocardial infarction, stroke, coronary revascularization, means you have to go to surgery again for a bypass surgery or a stent, angioplasty, or a hospitalization for a chest pain, angina. There was an 18% reduction in these five grouped together parameters in the chelated group versus the placebo group. I mean, that's an amazing reduction in these things, and I thought they were going to implement this as one of the major advances in coronary health in the United States, because sometimes when they have a 5% improvement with Lipitor, simvastatin, or other of the cholesterol-lowering drugs, they go crazy. Cardiology is going insane when there's a 3% reduction. We had an 18% reduction, and their conclusion was, well, we're not recommending this yet for treatment to the general population. We're going to repeat the study to see if it's true, because we're not sure it's true. So this is not a recommendation. It looks like a great recommendation. Especially, the reduction was seen in diabetic patients. 39% reduction in those five parameters. All of this statistically significant. Chances of having an anterior myocardial infarction, 37% reduction. So I thought that was a great study. But they're doing it again. So we're spending our money again. lead exposure and progression of renal disease. Chronic renal failure is an epidemic in the United States. And this is a randomized study that has shown, number one, 100% of patients with chronic renal failure have heavy metals in the kidneys, closing the kidney, causing the renal failure. You see how important it is for you to remove mercury from human bodies. I mean, that's one of the most important strategies anyone can be doing in the United States right now. So that's why I'm here today. I mean, I applaud you and encourage you to continue, because I know you're one in a thousand, unfortunately, but it's spreading quickly. And fortunately, this is a reversible process. There's many randomized studies. Just one of them is from the New England Journal of Medicine, where there was a significant reduction of renal disease at 2 years. When they took patients with chronic renal failure and did EDTA calcium in a three-hour infusion, even though they could have done it in 10 minutes, randomized these patients for weekly treatment versus placebo with water. The weekly patients that got chelated, it reversed their kidney damage, improved their kidney function. None of them went into dialysis versus 25% of the other group that went into dialysis and got worse systematically. So very interesting what we're seeing. It has been shown already in many studies. The three-hour infusions we used to do until 2012, but very little in the last 7 years. And you use a 500cc bag, up to 3 grams of EDTA disodium, 5 grams of ascorbic acid, sodium bicarbonate, potassium chloride. I'll be happy to send you all this information. But one of the most important things we found in terms of how to predict treatment response was that the less you travel to the clinic, the better results you had. If you had to travel more than 35 minutes to our clinic, the results dropped significantly. So, and that makes sense. When you're in a car, you're constantly moving. And it didn't make a difference if you were driving or you're a passenger. You're moving, so your body's constantly compensating for that movement. If you move this way, your body's trying to move you this way. So you're constantly moving, wasting energy, and that decreasing energy decreases the results. The IV push with EDTA calcium, the idea originally came from Gary Gordon. Gary Gordon has been doing chelation therapy in the United States for 50 years. Gary mentioned that to me, and I said, aren't you going to harm the kidneys with that? He said, no. So I started doing this. We did a total of 445 patients from 2010 to 2014 in the Big Island of Puerto Rico. We did about 5,000 treatments with EDTA calcium. The results were much better, because I think that when you do a three-hour infusion, you get lower levels for a longer amount of time, lower levels of chelation in the blood. With the IV push, you get higher levels in the blood for a shorter amount of time. And that higher level will give me results that I was not getting with the other treatment. So I started switching immediately in terms of cholesterol, arthritis, all the parameters that we looked at, and higher percentages. So if we see patients that have elevated lipids, any type of cardiovascular disease, high blood pressure, cardiac symptomatology, chronic renal failure, diabetes, or arthritis, those are indications for chelation therapy. But in reality, I see it more as a public therapeutic measure. A public measure means that I will recommend it to everybody that lives in a major city in the United States or Puerto Rico or the world, because of the presence of heavy metals. After 2 to 4 treatments, we'll see results in more than 90% of the patients. There's always a percentage that we don't see it, but most of them, you'll see an improvement in many things in your life. And sometimes we don't realize how we are until we start removing intravenously some heavy metals from our blood and other toxins. The monitoring of these patients, of course, with the regular blood work, pH 3 times a day. Every 6 weeks we will do blood work. We always try to do organic food, removal of sugar and starch, and give 4 supplements that tend to remove toxins from the body and promote alkalinity. 4 things. It's very simple. I could probably write a book of 200 things that don't work very well, and specific brands, but I would get into a lot of trouble doing that. But four things that do work are goji berries, chlorella, which is a green algae, probiotics, and vitamin C. And there's specific brands and specific forms, but roughly those four things, while we're monitoring your pH, we'll start raising the pH of most patients within 2 weeks. And you can measure this, and you can see the clinical effects. And we do the above for 2 weeks before starting the chelation therapy to release the discomfort from detoxification and increase the efficacy of therapy. We start a multivitamin. We used to use a BCI, which was a preparation from Longevity Plus that's no longer available, which was also oral chelation. And calcium EDTA was calculated based on weight, height, age, and creatinine. The infusion is done slowly, 5 to 10 minutes, intravenous weekly injections, and then we reevaluate patients prospectively. This is very important, and you can do chelation therapy, but these things are very important, these two things. Number one, patients have to eat before coming for a treatment, because immediately the metabolism goes up, because immediately starts pulling metals from the arteries and veins, and this will lead to some opening of capillaries, and this will lead to cells realizing they have food available, cells waking up, increasing their metabolism. This happens in a matter of minutes. We've measured it. And if the patient is fasting, they'll have a drop in blood sugar, which could be very uncomfortable. So always eat beforehand. The second thing is, never give the calculated dose in the first treatment. It's like asking you to run a marathon the first day of training. That cannot happen. You have to train slowly. The same thing goes for your capacity to remove heavy metals and other things from your body. So we do 20% of the calculated dose the first week, 40% the next week. By the fifth week, we're at 100%. And that reduces the discomfort of detoxification to practically zero. So we see mostly benefits. The results of these protocols, lowering of total cholesterol in 75% of the patients, of glucose levels in 78%, disappearance of joint pains regardless of etiology. It could be rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, traumatic arthritis, the disappearance of joint pain. It could be a chikungunya. More energy and sleeping better, 100% of the patients. Decreasing medications in all patients, including insulin, hypoglycemics, antihypertensives, and pain medications. Decreasing creatinine and urinary protein in 85% of the patients with chronic renal failure. And the side effects, increasing blood pressure in one patient after administering 20% more than the calculated dose, that was a mistake of our part. Death of one patient due to bradycardia from taking metoprolol. Metoprolol induced bradycardia, causing patients to need a pacemaker, is an epidemic now in the United States and Puerto Rico. You know why they give you metoprolol? So when you have an upset with either your wife or husband or your kids, your blood pressure doesn't go up and you get a heart attack. But the trade-off for that is that you're running around with a bradycardia that makes you feel tired, you don't have a zest for life, and sometimes the bradycardia is so severe that you're hospitalized needing an immediate pacemaker placement. So this is happening in the United States now, instead of going to the cause of the problem, which is that you have to get rid of your husband, for example. Or your wife, allergic reaction, an angioedema patient. I've had one allergic reaction to EDTA in 21 years. And the patient responded well to Benadryl and epinephrine. He had angioedema. He was closing his throat. But we have the means in the office to finish the reaction. Then we started sending him to an allergist for the desensitization. And now he's getting weekly intravenous EDTA again with no reaction. So even though we had, the reason why we would do that in someone that almost dies from a reaction, because he had prostate cancer, recurrent prostate cancer, that responded to the EDTA, that was the cause of the tumor, the PSA normalized to less than one from five. He had no evidence of disease from the EDTA. When he stopped it, the PSA continued to rise. We restarted the EDTA, he's in remission again. That is why, because we didn't want that tumor to get out of control. And the tumor was due to toxins. Here we go again. Remember the first slide that I presented today. Other side effects, chills from infected catheter, one patient's skin pimples. The IV push in patients is much more, is faster, and this is the 50 patients from Vieques that received EDTA. And there's something I'm going to mention to you today, which I don't mention often. Many of these patients also receive intravenous ozone for two reasons. One, we already had a venous access, and administering 5 to 10 cc's of intravenous ozone has almost a zero risk, and it can have the benefit of disintegrating the deposits of cholesterol, fatty acids, and calcium that are the cause of many of the diseases, cardiovascular and otherwise, in these patients. So we administer 20 gamma direct intravenous ozone, 5 to 25 cc's every 2 to 4 weeks for 10 treatments in most of these patients. 30 patients receive at least 10 treatments for a total of 335 treatments on average. 5-minute infusions of EDTA calcium. Remember, EDTA calcium. You cannot do this intravenous infusion with EDTA disodium or magnesium. That's very dangerous. And the results in this population are very comparable to the results in the larger island. Lowering of total cholesterol, they actually seem to be higher, but this is not a randomized study. Lowering of total cholesterol in 85% of the patients, of sugar levels in 92%, disappearing of joint pains in 95%, and more energy and sleeping better in 100% of these patients. Three patients with prostate cancer had a decrease of their elevated PSA, which was more than 4, to less than 1. And that's where we got the idea 2 years ago to starting to treat the patients in the Big Island with chelation and ozone for prostate cancer that has not been treated yet or that has failed therapy. We have a series of 18 patients, and we're presenting that in the future. But it looks promising. Because, like we saw, toxins are causing cancer in the United States and Puerto Rico and the rest of the world. One patient had resolution of asthma, another patient had resolution of allergies. These are the patients that we're treating in the Big Island, and they've had PSA reductions, most of them, but we're still analyzing this data. This is not complete. So in conclusion, the results of adding ozone to these patients in Vieques to the EDTA seems to be more effective for most diseases for which EDTA seems to be effective. EDTA with or without concomitant ozone for the removal of heavy metals is associated with improvement or disappearance of many diseases, such as diabetes, high blood pressure, hypercholesterolemia, allergies, renal failure, asthma, fatigue, and insomnia. We routinely recommend this protocol for patients before and after amalgam removal. And these are the slides that I was just sent by Braulio Jimenez-Velez. I met Braulio a year ago in an IAOMT meeting in Puerto Rico. He's a professor in toxicology, PhD in the University of Puerto Rico Dental School. And he said to me, Victor, send me the data on these patients of the Big Island and the smaller island, and we'll compare it. And we confirmed what we had seen before, that there were more heavy metals in Vieques, and this is an analysis that was done. As you can see here, the first red block means lead. The second gray block also means lead. The first one is Vieques, and in average, the amount of lead in view of Vieques people is much higher, which is average here, than in the Big Island. So it's a statistically significant higher level of lead in Vieques than the Big Island, as well as aluminum. Higher levels in average, higher levels in average than the Big Island. This is the Big Island of Puerto Rico. Vieques is here. Is it there? Yeah. No. Yeah, Vieques is right here. That little strip of land here. This is the Big Island of Puerto Rico. This is Dominican Republic. I don't know why Florida is here. I used to live in Miami. You know, the good thing about Miami is so close to the United States, so. This is the second slide that I was sent, and uranium, radioactive uranium. Where do you get uranium? You don't get uranium in the general population like you do other metals like aluminum, lead that are used for many uses. So we started wondering, where is this uranium coming from? Where in the Big Island, we had 23% of the patients with uranium. Guess how many in Vieques? 78% of our population had evidence of uranium in their urine. And of course, we know that depleted uranium is used as a tip in many of these ballistic missiles to penetrate hardcore metal husks like tanks and other artillery. And initially, the Navy said they did not use uranium. Later, they said, yes, they did by mistake. They don't know how that got in there. I mean, this is the real version. It is tragic, but and now they're doing a very minimal cleanup, which I don't even know what it is, of the island in the last 14 years. And aluminum used to be used as a chaff. They call it chaff. Chaff is pieces of aluminum that are put on top of different structures like a sea ship, a convoy, to deflect radar waves. So you will not be as detectable as if you did not have aluminum. If you had a higher density metal, you're more detected. So they use a lot of chaff, which sometimes was just a dust that was sprayed on these convoys. So we think that may be where some of this aluminum is coming from. And as you can see here, just repeating that, lead in Vieques, Big Island. Aluminum, Vieques, Big Island. And regardless of the age group, 34 to 54 versus 55, 75, we saw the same trend. And of course, one of the things that we want to stress is that blood levels are not accurate. Blood levels, we've shown that are not an accurate way to detect heavy metals. So remember that, because the EPA, the FDA, most medical associations will do a blood test of aluminum, lead, mercury, uranium, comes out negative, and they say, this patient is fine. But if you remember, if you're going to do a blood level, and that's what the insurance pays, you can do it. You can prescribe it Monday. But remember to do it after a EDTA provocation. So if your patient does EDTA today, then after that, tell them to go to the lab. And then we will see the results that I'm mentioning here. And one rule of thumb that I recommend is to remove amalgams only after patients' diseases or well-being are improving significantly, with supplements or IV therapies, because the less heavy metal burden you have, the easier that removal will be, not in terms of your expertise and your procedure, but in terms of what may escape is not going to harm the patient. So in general, I recommend to do before and after chelation, vitamin C, supplementation, whatever other techniques you're going to do, before or after removal. And you should do the same as well, because no matter how many masks we can use or vacuum cleaners, it's always good to have a healthy practitioner so you don't get the exposure and we don't get sick during removal of mercury. So for patient and dentist, before and after removal of heavy metals. And thank you very much for your attention.